Hanover Square Press and Harper Audio present Broken Faith, Inside the Word of Faith Fellowship, One of America's Most Dangerous Cults, by Mitch Weiss and Holbrook Mohr, read by Vivienne Leheny. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/broken faith. It contains a cast of characters, notes on sources, further reading materials, and more. Beware of false prophets who come to you dressed as sheep, but inside they are devouring wolves. Matthew chapter 7, verse 15. Introduction. This is the troubling story of the Word of Faith Fellowship and the lives destroyed by this secretive church in the foothills of North Carolina's Blue Ridge Mountains. The events depicted in this book come from extensive interviews with more than 100 former members of the sect, their relatives, advocates, current and retired law enforcement officials, and others. We spent years researching and reporting this story, reviewing thousands of pages of documents, ranging from child custody cases to police reports. We reviewed more than 100 hours of video and audio recordings, many of which were secretly recorded by former congregants. We listened to dozens of tape-recorded sermons by Jane Whaley and other key church leaders from the mid-1990s. Much of the documentation chronicling the earliest allegations of abuse in the church is based on a damning 315-page report prepared by the North Carolina State Bureau of Investigation in 1995. Never publicly released, most of the information in the report is being revealed for the first time. Information on Word of Faith Fellowship leader Jane Whaley and other ministers is based on dozens of interviews, legal documents, bankruptcy filings, court cases, published material, and a 208-page sworn deposition of Whaley on April 27, 2017. Part of a contentious child custody case, Whaley's deposition has never been released to the public. Biographical information on many of the current members and church leaders is based on their own words. Shortly after the Associated Press published its first in a series of articles about the Word of Faith Fellowship in February 2017, some congregants posted videos online to challenge what the church called media lies. And beginning in December 2017, the Word of Faith Fellowship purchased airtime on WCAB, a Rutherfordton, North Carolina-based radio station, every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Nearly 200 members of the Word of Faith Fellowship have used the broadcast to deny allegations made against their church, criticize former members and their advocates, or give glowing testimonies about their experiences in the congregation. Videos of the radio programs have been posted on YouTube.com under a channel titled WFF Speaks Out, as well as on the church's website. Church leaders categorically deny that any abuse takes place at the Word of Faith Fellowship. The survivors stand by their stories. Part 1. In the Beginning. Prologue. The Escape. John David Cooper bounded out the front door with a trash bag in his arms. This had to be the last of it. He was out of breath and out of time. He and his wife Jessica had been stuffing their clothes and belongings into their Corolla for what seemed like hours, but really it had been 10 minutes. Jessica was headed back inside. John stopped her. "We gotta leave," he said.
"But we still have more things."
"We can get them later." She shook her head. She knew that wasn't true. Once they left, that was it. But if they stayed, they'd lose even more.
"One more trip, just to make sure. I won't take long," she said.
She broke into a run, down the hallway and into the bedroom. John sighed, Stay calm, he thought. He checked his watch. The Wednesday night church service had just started. In only a matter of minutes, they'd realized John and Jessica weren't there. Come on, he muttered. The tree-lined street was utterly quiet, the picture of American middle-class prosperity. John and Jessica shared a tidy home with Jessica's parents and sister, in a neighborhood of respectable one- and two-story dwellings filled with other Word of Faith Fellowship members. Everyone kept an eye on their neighbors. No one went anywhere or talked to anyone new without someone taking note. Anything odd was immediately reported to a church leader. Anyone who looked the other way, or kept a secret, might well face the wrath of Jane Whaley. She was God's anointed, a prophet, the spiritual leader of Word of Faith Fellowship. John and Jessica had planned this day for months, down to the very last detail. It had to be on a Wednesday or Sunday night, when everybody was in church for the 6:30 p.m. service. The house was 10 minutes from the church's 35-acre compound. They'd told Jessica's mom and dad, Randy and Cynthia Fields, they were heading out to gas up the car before church, just in case they wondered why they were leaving early. They left the house at 6:10 p.m. At the BP station, they filled the tank. At 6:25 p.m., they returned to the house, parked at the side door, and started loading up their things. At 6:30 p.m. on Wednesday, everyone, including any stragglers, would be in the sanctuary, starting the first praise choruses. They had only 10 minutes to grab everything and get out. Once church members realized they weren't there, the Word of Faith security team would come looking for them. John could hear dresser drawers opening and closing. Come on, Jessica, he shouted. The car was stuffed. He opened a rear door and jammed his bag inside. Jessica came through the door, dragging a final bag, probably the biggest one of all. I don't know how we're going to find room, John said.
Just throw it in, she said.
Where?
I don't know, just take it.
Her voice wavered. John shoved the bag into the pile and slammed the door. He was sweating, his blue button-down shirt plastered to his back. He fumbled in his pocket for the car keys. He felt like a bank robber, loaded with loot and ready to make his getaway. Except he wasn't stealing anything. All they had were their personal belongings. They had to escape this miserable place. John jammed the key into the ignition, and the car roared to life. Jessica jumped into the passenger seat. He took a deep breath. Jessica was trembling. You okay? He asked. She nodded.
Yes, let's go.
John was 18 months old when his parents joined Word of Faith Fellowship, an independent evangelical Christian church in tiny Spindale, North Carolina. Throughout his life, he had been choked, punched, and beaten to expel the demons they said possessed his soul. He had been publicly humiliated by Jane Whaley from the pulpit and harangued for long hours by ministers and congregants in a discipline they called blasting. He was isolated from the outside world, forbidden television, radio, newspapers, and movies. He'd lived for long stretches in ministers' homes, separated from his parents and most of his 8 siblings. For years, John Cooper did not know this wasn't normal. Everyone else in his world had been abused in the same ways. Life inside the church was brutal, but running away was risky too. Where would he go? Anyone who left Word of Faith would likely never see his friends or family again. As such, attackers were cut out of the lives of the faithful. After today, John would be dead to his family. He had been bracing himself for that reality. He wasn't sure Jessica was ready for that. She was close to her family, especially her mother. Jessica probably still believed that Whaley was a prophet. They'd been taught that anyone who left the church would face the wrath of God. They'd die a slow death from cancer, or be killed in a car accident, or be struck by lightning. Their souls would be damned for eternity. John had stopped believing that nonsense a long time ago. But Jessica? She had been talking more and more about what might happen to them if Whaley really did have mystical powers. It had to be nerves, he thought. Jane Whaley was a fraud. That would become clear to Jessica once they were on the outside, around normal people. Their lives were going to get better. He was starting medical school. Their futures were bright. All they had to do was head east, to Charlotte, out of Whaley's reach. John glanced at his watch. It was 6:40 p.m. The two-lane wound down to U.S. 74. He'd traveled it hundreds of times. Every second counted. He hit the gas.
Slow down,
Jessica said. I'm going the speed limit. Jessica's phone rang. She looked at the screen. It was her mother. Her parents knew. Whaley knew. The police probably knew, too. Don't answer it, John said. This was part of the escape plan. They'd agreed they wouldn't answer their phones. Jessica looked ahead, staring at the white lines on the road. Only a few more miles, and they'd jump on the highway and leave Rutherford County behind. But a car appeared in the rearview mirror, speeding in their direction. Could it be the security team? They couldn't stop. Their future depended on it. 1. Moving Day, September 19th, 1993. Suzanne Cooper checked off the last item on her list. The boxes were labeled and loaded in the vehicles just outside the door. She'd make one last sweep of the house to be sure nothing was left. Someone tugged on her pant leg. Benjamin, grinning the gap-toothed grin of a 7-year-old.
Mom, when are we leaving?
Suzanne sighed.
Real soon.
Can we still play?
Yes, keep an eye on your little brothers.
Benjamin bolted to the front yard to join his older siblings, Jeffrey and Lena. 5-year-old Peter was trying to keep up with them. Meanwhile, Suzanne's husband, Rick, had his hands full with the two toddlers, Chad and John David. 6 Cooper kids, each born 2 years apart, running around the yard with their dad, who almost qualified as another child, Suzanne thought. She smiled at the sweet scene, pressing it into her memory. She wouldn't see it again. She forgot for a moment the Ryder truck parked in the driveway, packed with all of their possessions. Their blue Chevrolet cargo van was parked just behind it, likewise stuffed with clothes, books, games, and flashcards to keep the children busy during the long trip. They'd lived in Darien, Georgia for 4 years, and Suzanne had loved the old rental house with its big yard, the neighboring couples with children, the friendly townspeople. Darien had offered Suzanne stability, something she'd missed for the first 12 years of her marriage. Her husband was a sailor, an engineer on a U.S. Navy nuclear submarine. Every time they got settled and made friends, they'd up and move again, usually just after a baby arrived. They'd lived in Hawaii, Washington, Italy, and Florida. Darien, Georgia was their latest stop, a community of cypress trees, cobblestone streets, a simple, very southern place. Neighbors looked out for each other. Everyone went to church on Sunday morning. After 20 years, Rick had retired from the Navy, and the family now would move to Spindale, North Carolina, where he'd study to become a pastor. The screen door slammed. Rick had John David in his arms.
Are you ready?
She nodded.
Okay, let's get everyone in the van, he said.
I'll be out in a minute,
she said. Suzanne was apprehensive about this move. It didn't help that Rick made this life-changing decision without consulting her. It was typical Rick. He never thought things through, and it was up to Suzanne to make it work out.
Maybe that's how Christian marriages work.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.